Welcome to the next episode in the iron deficiency series. Today, we will be talking about common iron deficiency symptoms. Medical disclaimer. I am not a medical doctor, nor do I have any formal medical training. All content found in this video, text, images, audio, figures, etc., is for informational purposes only. The information presented is from my own research and my interpretation of that research. This video is not intended to be a substitute for professional medical advice, diagnosis, or treatment. Always seek the advice of your physician or other qualified health provider with any questions you may have regarding a medical condition. Never disregard professional medical advice or delay in seeking it because of something you have heard or read about in this video. You should never supplement iron without physician oversight. Too much iron is dangerous and possibly fatal. The list of symptoms that I'm about to talk about have come from a journal paper. The paper is titled Iron Deficiency Without Anemia, Common, Important, Neglected by Issa Soapy. This is a really great paper for reference, and it's actually one of the first papers that I read. So if you haven't come across this yet in your research, this is definitely a paper that you want to read and have on hand. So in the paper, I think it might be table 2, he lists all of the common and less common symptoms for low ferritin. And obviously these are going to overlap with those that are experienced by those who have iron deficiency anemia. So I know it looks like a lot. We'll go through each one. The ones that are highlighted in red are the symptoms that I actually experienced, and you can see that it's basically a majority of this list. And obviously, a lot of them, you know, are quite vague and can be attributed to other things, but a lot of these symptoms I had actually sought out medical care for, you know, over the past decade or so that I've had this condition. So they are likely attributed to that. The first one, which a lot of people tend to experience, is exceptional fatigue. So for me, that meant I was basically in bed quite a bit. And it was definitely more pronounced when I was on my menstrual cycle on the heaviest days and also after my menstrual cycle, because obviously, you know, he had just suffered a lot of blood, or some of us suffer a lot of blood loss. So I was really, really tired. I mean, not even, I use the word tired, but I mean, my breathing would get really shallow and it just felt like my body was going to collapse. And so the only thing I could do was just basically lay down. The next is reduced mental awareness. So obviously our brains need iron to function properly. And so it can be, you know, difficult to just kind of be aware of what's going on around you and, you know, be able to concentrate and things like that. It's sort of like a brain fog almost, which ties into the next point of absent-mindedness and poor concentration. You might find it harder to focus and concentrate on tasks. Headaches, I did not experience any of these. Another big symptom that a lot of people tend to struggle with is hair loss. And I can remember in graduate school, I would be basically losing, clumps of hair. They would basically fill the palm of my hand. So it was a substantial hair loss. And as my ferritin has raised, that has actually reduced by quite a bit. And now I only lose like a tiny little bit of hair. So, I mean, it's a huge, huge difference. And I have noticed a little bit of hair regrowth. You can really see it, you know, at the front of the hairline, you can see little hairs growing in. It's kind of cute, actually. The next is muscle and joint pain. So I did have a lot of this. I'm not sure if it was tied to iron or not, but I've noticed in the past year or so, since my iron has gone up, I actually don't have that pain anymore. So I had just attributed it to exercise, but it was constant. So maybe it was due to the low iron. Edema, which is just, you know, swelling with fluid. I did not experience any of that. Another symptom that's fairly common amongst people and that I hear talked about a lot is shortness of breath, also known as dyspnea. I had a lot of that, and it would mostly show up before my menstrual cycle. I'm not quite sure why, and it would show up as air hunger. So it always felt like you weren't getting a deep enough breath. I would have some shortness of breath going up the stairs and when I exercise, but the main thing was this air hunger, which was incorrectly attributed to anxiety at one point. But another one that you can experience, particularly if your ferritin and your iron is really low, is a very high resting heart rate and rapid acceleration of heart rate during exertion. I did not experience this, thankfully. You can also get some palpitations, which I did have, but I don't think it was tied to the iron. It was tied to something else that I had going on. Weight gain, I did not experience that. Loss of initiative. So, obviously if you're super exhausted all the time, you are not going to be taking the initiative. Memory lapses. I have had quite a few memory issues, particularly with my short-term memory. People tell me something and then I forget it almost immediately. So, I laugh about it, but it's actually not funny because I'm, forgetting important things. Difficulties finding words. Did have some of that and still have some of that now. Vertigo. I did not experience any episodes of vertigo, but I did have a lot of lightheadedness. So not dizziness, not vertigo, but lightheaded. So you feel kind of like woozy almost like you're gonna faint. And whenever I would have panic attacks, this would get really, really, really bad. Depression. I had very, very severe depression when my ferritin was low. I think I've been depressed for a while, but didn't know I was depressed until I wasn't depressed. It's kind of one of those things you can only figure out looking back once you're out of the hole. And the depression was unresponsive to everything. Like all of the medications that we threw at it, and we threw quite a few medications at it from a bunch of different classes, and it just wasn't moving. But the iron completely eradicated it, even at a ferritin level 30, which is still technically deficient. That's the boundary for defining iron deficiency, at least in the scientific literature, not according to US clinical guidelines. But if you look at the literature, that seems to be the boundary for iron deficiency. And so, even going up, from 16 to 30 seems to have gotten rid of it, and it has stayed away even through the winter, which I'm shocked. The next thing is anxiety. Oh, back to the depression. A lot of people tend to see their depression either lift or completely go away if it was solely due to low iron or low ferritin. The next is anxiety. I mean, your body, right? An iron deficiency means your oxygen is not being properly managed in your body, and you need iron to synthesize, different neurotransmitters and stuff that help keep you calm. And if you're low on that, you're obviously going to have panic attacks and anxiety and things like that. I know people that have gotten iron infusions and their anxiety like just completely went away. But I think I think to get the anxiety to go away, I think you have to go a lot higher than you do for the depression. Or maybe that's person dependent. But at least in my experience, the depression was first to go. Anxiety, I think, takes a lot longer. And unfortunately for me, despite getting regular iron infusions, I do still struggle with significant anxiety and panic attacks. The next is globus. So that would be like a feeling of a lump in your throat. I have had a little bit of that. Pharyngeal irritation and phlegm. Haven't had too much of that. Dysphagia. So that's basically when you're choking on your food. And that's something I didn't identify as an iron deficiency, but now that I don't choke on my food and liquids, since my iron's gone up, I now know that it was due to this, and now that I see it listed in this symptoms chart, I was like, oh, so that's what that was. I'm coughing, I didn't have any of that. Heartburn, did have a little bit of that. Cold hands and feet is another big one. So obviously, low iron, poor circulation, they kind of all go hand in hand, and you have very cold extremities. The next is diaphoresis, which is just medical language for sweating, and then no sweating. This is kind of a weird symptom since they're opposites, but I didn't have either of these symptoms. Restless legs is another big one that people tend to experience. So for me, this was the defining symptom that actually made me call the doctor's office to see about getting some blood work to check my iron levels. my restless legs was so bad that it was basically keeping me up all night, and then it started spreading to my body, and it just got really, really uncomfortable. And for those that don't know, restless legs or restless body basically produces these sensations in the body that are basically only relieved once you move. And so if you have restless legs, you're constantly moving your legs around, stretching your legs, same thing with your body. It can get quite uncomfortable and very disruptive. And when I Googled it to see what some of the causes might be, iron deficiency was one of the first things that came up. So I was like, huh, maybe this is what I have. The next is reduced aerobic performance. And obviously, you know, again, it gets back to mismanagement of oxygen. So obviously your aerobic performance isn't going to be as great. Myalgia, which is just muscle pain associated with even slight muscle strain. I had a lot of that. Sleeping disturbances. So I have a lot of trouble getting to sleep and staying asleep. So again, this was attributed incorrectly to anxiety, which I'm not saying, you know, a lot of people do have anxiety at nighttime and it can disturb your sleep. But for me, I was not having racing thoughts or anything like that. I just couldn't sleep. Like my, you know, circadian rhythm or something was just off. Since raising my ferritin, that has gotten a little bit better. Abnormal menstruation. So I'm not quite sure how this manifests, because I've kind of had two different problems going on. The first is sort of irregular menstrual cycles where they can be back to back, or the duration of the cycle length is constantly changing, and also very heavy menstruation. So I've heard anecdotally that as you raise your iron, your periods actually get lighter. So my periods have gotten lighter, but I also had another issue going on with copper poisoning that could have contributed to that. So I'm just going to have to see how this plays out. But I marked it as red because I do have it. I'm not sure what it's tied to yet. Mild pyrexia, so mild fever. No, I didn't have any of that. Well, sometimes I feel warm. I don't know. I didn't mark it down. Dry skin and pruritus. So that's basically itching skin. Easy bruising. That was another symptom that I didn't realize was tied to an iron deficiency until after it had gone away. And I was getting a lot of giant bruises on the upper back of my thigh. So the bruises would be like the size of my palm. And I could never figure out where they came from. And one of my doctors falsely attributed it to a medication that I was taking that didn't have illicit as a side effect. And it went away as my iron went up. So pretty sure it was due to that. Some of the less common symptoms, rash, I didn't have that. Stinging tongue discomfort and pain. I did have quite a bit of that actually at the start of my low ferritin, and that went away pretty quickly as my ferritin went up. Abdominal symptoms, I did not have any of those. Loss of appetite and nausea. These were also huge symptoms for me that were severely impacting my quality of life and that were not being taken seriously, in my opinion, by the doctors. And again, it was blamed on stress, anxiety, depression, you know, all the usual scapegoats, basically. And it was very difficult for me to eat. Some days it would take me the whole day just to eat an English muffin with peanut butter. And at some point I had to transition to just drinking smoothies to try and get my nutrition, because I physically could not eat food. Like I wanted to eat, like mentally I wanted to eat, but my body would not accept or allow any food. And that obviously contributes to fatigue and then causes other types of, you know, vitamin and mineral imbalances and impacts your overall health. And it's just, you know, it ticked me off that it wasn't taken that seriously. And I didn't realize that it was tied to iron deficiency. Again, now that my ferritin's raised a little bit, I'm eating like a horse and I've gained like 10 pounds from eating, and I feel so much better. Like I have an actual appetite. I actually have cravings for salads, which I have never had. Like you can ask people that know me if I eat salads, and they'll tell you they've never even seen me eat a salad. So it's amazing like how that has turned around.
Next is dysesthesia, just pins and needles of the extremities. Had a little bit of that. Weight loss, which I should have marked that in red. Well, technically speaking, my weight didn't drop because I forced the food in as best as I could. But if you were to compare it to the weight that I should be while eating normally, it is technically a weight loss. Visual disturbances in blurred vision, inexplicable fluctuations in blood glucose values, diabetics, irritability and anger tantrums. So again, like I said earlier, iron is very important in the production of neurotransmitters in the brain. And so it's crucial for mood regulation. Feeling sick, so kind of feeling under the weather at times. It did feel a little bit of that. Tinnitus and buzzing of the ears. I have that right now, and it's a high-pitched ringing sound, and it is super obnoxious. I know there's different types of tinnitus that you can have. Like, some people hear beeps, some people hear crickets, some people just have a high-pitched ee sound, which is what I have. Some people hear waves, trains, all kinds of music, all kinds of stuff. So I'm not sure if iron deficiency, if you hear a specific sound or not. I didn't really look into that. Muscle cramping, again, that gets back to the myalgia, kind of. Hot skin, poor heat tolerance was another big one for me. So I could not handle and still really can't handle heat. And I don't live in a place that gets very hot. So anything, I would say before, like when I first started, I would keep my apartment like cool from, you know, like May to September. I'd be the only one. I would look outside in the parking lot. I'd be the only person with their AC running. So I know that I have a problem because I'm the only one that's running their AC constantly. That has since gotten a little bit better, but still probably not where it needs to be. Syncope, episodes of memory loss. So I never fainted, but I have felt close. Like, I've gotten the tunnel vision. You know, I've gotten the signs of presyncope, but I've never actually passed out. Pale skin. So my skin is pretty pale, and I think back to when I snowshoed one time with one of my friends, and I remember her looking at me and saying, "Ashley, are you okay? You look really pale." So apparently it's pretty noticeable. The other thing that you'll notice too, if you were to pull down your inner eyelid and look in your inner eyelid, it'll be white in there. Also indicating an iron deficiency problem. Low and variable blood pressure. I do have a little bit of that. Rapid impairment of academic skills can happen. Falling asleep involuntarily. Pica disorder. So cravings or eating non-food substances. I can remember one day I was putting up gel window clings in my bedroom, and my mouth started salivating. So I don't know if my body thought the window cling was a gummy, if it was food. Nail clubbing and Plummer-Vinson syndrome, which I don't know anything about. So yeah, so that's the list of symptoms. And then I sort of pointed out as we went along, like, which ones were the most severe for me. Restless legs, that's the one that made me seek out laboratory work to see what was going on. Nausea and loss of appetite were also a big issue. Fatigue, depression, anxiety, cold hands and feet, abnormal menstruation, easy bruising, dysphagia, tinnitus, and poor heat tolerance. So yeah, I find it really helpful. You know, this paper is open source and it's free to everyone. So I find it really helpful to just go and, you know, look at the paper and print it off and then just kind of highlight the symptoms that you're having so you can see, you know, kind of what's going on. And, you know, when you go and see your doctor, you can just point to this list and be like, well, you know, well, maybe not to the whole list, write down like your top five, and then just talk to your doctor and be like, I think I might, you know, have this, you know, I have all these symptoms, and talk to your doctor and say, you know, I have this list of symptoms. I think I could have iron deficiency, you know, because of XYZ reasons, and maybe get tested for it. So yeah, I hope, this helps someone, and stay tuned for the next episode where we will be talking about iron deficiency labs and what lab work should be done in order to diagnose you.